walk in the building.
Yes.
All right, I'd like to go ahead and call to order the Station Resource Committee meeting. It's running a little behind, so we'll try and move this as best we can, but I do know we have a lot of comment on all of these items.
Well, on action item number one, I'm the chair of the Homeland Advisory Group. I need a membership roster and approve of it. I will approve that item.
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Thank you.
I guess there's no one.
We have some members of our Homeland Advisory Group actually here, so.
Any public comments?
I don't think they need comments.
All right, if that item passes.
And if they thought they did.
All right, on to informational items. Oh, what?
I think we need to call roll.
Oh, sorry. Please go ahead and call roll.
Dr. Liu?
Aye.
Supervisor Q?
Aye.
Supervisor.
Or is it just here?
No. Supervisor is not available. Supervisor Rutherford?
Here.
Council member Benoit?
Here.
That's the vote.
You should call the roll.
Yeah, someone said call the roll. Okay.
I hear presence, yes.
Yes. Do we need a roll call vote for this because of the remote location? There's no one there. So I think we're okay.
Motion passes with all yes.
That's what I thought. Okay. All right, onto the first informational item, summary of proposed rule 1430. Susan, go ahead.
So proposed rule 1430 is the metal grinding rule that occurs at metal forging facilities. And by way of background, back in 2012, the South Coast Air Quality Management District started to receive comments or complaints about a metallic odor in the city of Paramount. And so through investigative work, the South Coast SCAQMD had identified Carlton Forge Works, a forging facility in the city of Paramount, and had then since put air monitors. And the air monitors were collecting data that would do what were referred to as multi-metals, and so a suite of metals. And the two metals of concern were hexavalent chrome and nickel. As we monitored the results and as Carlton Forge started to implement a variety of voluntary measures, we saw the nickel levels reduced, but we didn't see the same pattern for the hexavalent chrome, indicating that there was another source of hexavalent chrome that could be something else within the forging operation or possibly another source outside of Carlton Forge Works. So the issue of the hexavalent chrome in the city of Paramount with expanded monitoring is where we found the very high elevated levels of hexavalent chrome is different from this proposed rulemaking. This proposed rulemaking will address metal particulate and some of those metal particulates are toxic air contaminants. Hexavalent chrome doesn't seem to be one of the main toxic air contaminants associated with the grinding operations, but we do see some hexavalent chrome in some grinding operations. So we've been asked to make that distinction and clarity in the rulemaking. So staff then began the rulemaking effort for regulating grinding operations at forging facilities. It's currently an unregulated source, so we're starting with a clean slate, having to look and investigate and find these particular facilities. The need for the rule, this is metal grinding is currently an exempt category in terms of requiring the AKMD permit. Ambient monitors were showing that we needed to do more, and so staff went to most of the forging facilities to take a look at their grinding operations. Their grinding operations are quite intense. Some of these facilities were grinding, when we started the rulemaking, four facilities are actually grinding in the open air with no controls. Some facilities had controls, but not to the level of controls that we're going to propose in the rule. The maintenance on some of the controls were of concern. Many of the facilities had some type of housekeeping, but did not have sufficient housekeeping to minimize fugitive emissions from that would escape their facility boundary. Public process, we've worked through a working group, and there are four facilities in the city of Paramount, actually five facilities in total that are affected in the city of Paramount by this proposed rulemaking. The community had requested that we hold some of the working group meetings, and we're going to hold a public consultation in the city of Paramount. So the general overview of the rule applies to metal forging facilities. We've identified 22 facilities that would be affected by the proposed rule. Objective is to reduce particulate, metal particulate. Some of that metal particulate is toxic air, are toxic air contaminants. The rule will, with through the enclosures and other measures, also help to reduce odors from the facility. So we identify that as part of the objective. This is just to give you an overview of the kind of the intensity of the grinding operations. Billet grinding is are by far the most intense type of grinding operation. You have an operator in the cab of the grinder, and it goes up and down a billet, which is like a long log, almost, you know, the length of the table, going back and forth grinding. There's swing grinders that are suspended from the ceiling or another attachment. And those grinding operations are also very intense. Stand grinders are usually mounted on a bench or on the floor, and it's a wheel. And then hand grinding, although it sounds like it's small, some of the hand grinding can be very intense in terms of the particular operation. The approach is similar to other rules where we have metal particulates, multifaceted approach, point source controls. What's not captured in the point source control, we have a total enclosure to encapsulate. And then whatever may escape from the enclosure and to reduce any track out, we have housekeeping provisions. Point source requirements, we have requirements for collection efficiency to ensure that the airflow is going to the hood. Point source requirements, so there's a standard of 0.002 grains per dry cubic standard feet. We were able to confirm this level to establish it in the rule based on a previous source test from a Carlton Forge with their HEPA filtration. We are requiring that all the facilities, as their final filtration, do have HEPA, and that they would have to do source tests. We also have requirements, because the grinding operation is not always in a fixed location, that we're requiring the operators to put markings so our inspectors can ensure that they're grinding in the correct location relative to the hood, and it'll also help the operators. There's the rule will prohibit any grinding in, to be conducted in the open air right off the bat from date of adoption. Would require facilities that are currently conducting in the open air to start grinding within at least a temporary enclosure. The rule would require all facilities to be grinding in a total enclosure or a total enclosure with negative air. During the time that these enclosures are being constructed, they would have to increase their housekeeping, either the frequency or the radius from the source, from the basic housekeeping requirements. The enclosure requirements, so if it's a facility that's located outside of beyond 300 feet from a sensitive receptor or 1,000 feet from a preschool or school, their requirement is just a total enclosure. For those that are within 300 feet of a sensitive receptor or 1,000 feet of a school or preschool, they would have to do a total enclosure with negative air. Total enclosures with negative air require the facility to be venting the air within the enclosure to a control device. The base velocity at all openings would have to be the specified limit of 200 feet per minute. This just highlights the housekeeping requirements. There's requirements in terms of wet cleaning, HEPA vacuuming on different locations within the grinding operation, and then also some other housekeeping provisions. Other proposed requirements, source testing annually. If they're 50% below the limit, so 0.001 grains per dry cubic standard feet, they would be able to source test every other year. We're requiring a multi-metal source test once every 4 years, and allowing them, if they can demonstrate through each catch, baghouse catch, that they're under 1% of total chromium, then they would be relieved of a third source test for hexavalent chrome. The proposed rule also has a signage requirement. It would require the facilities to post a sign outside of their facility that would allow the public to be able to contact the facility or contact us if there's an air quality issue or odor-related issue that they can call, and the facility would be required to log this information. So key comments on the rule. One comment is that they want clear communication regarding the issue and paramount with hexavalent chrome and this proposed rulemaking. We're going to make that distinction in the staff report. We're making the distinction in the presentation today. We'll make the distinction in the presentation to the board. The second comment in regards to sort of a one-size-fits-all, the rule is not a one-size-fits-all. There's variation in the rule. We exclude grinding heads that are less than 1 inch. We have provisions for small piece grinding. There's a differentiation in terms of the enclosure requirements for total enclosures and total enclosures with negative air, depending on the distance to a sensitive receptor or school. So there is definitely not a one-size-fits-all. There's variation incorporated into the rule. And then the third comment that we received is to have some type of mechanism to encourage continuous compliance and some trigger in the rule that would encourage a facility when they see that if they were to have an issue with their bag house or any non-compliant issue, that they don't want to get to that next layer of provisions, and that they want that the request is that we have incorporate something into the rule. So we're thinking about it. We're thinking about what those can be, what those sort of points could be that would really hold the facility's feet to the fire in terms of ensuring continued compliance. So we have three key issues that we're working on. One is to expand the trigger for the total enclosure with negative air. And so the requirement now currently is that we're proposing that if you're within 1,000 feet of a school, and we're adding the preschool, head start, pre-head start within that 1,000 feet, or 300 feet of a sensory receptor, that the facility would have to have a total enclosure with negative air. Originally, there was a request to expand that distance for the schools to 2,000 feet, and now the request is they're saying we're okay with 1,500 feet. Then we received another request at the public workshop yesterday that to expand the distance for the sensory receptor from 300 to 500 feet. So staff's recommendation at this point is that we maintain the 300 feet from the sensory receptor, 1,000 feet from a school or preschool. We're basing this on the CARB land use document that talks about the siting distances for, it was primarily hexavalent chrome, but we're talking about heavy metals. I think it's consistent with that. When we look at risk curves in terms of the drop off and where you see in terms of the distance, the 300 feet is pretty consistent. 1,000 feet is more of a precautionary principle, so it is very health protective at the 1,000 feet. Beyond the 1,000 feet, we would capture I think about three more schools that would be required. Three more facilities that would have to install enclosures, and about two more facilities at the 300 to 500 feet for the sensitive receptor. So we start to, expand that. The next key issue is in regards to the signage. The signage right now is that if there's an air quality odor, that we want the facility to we want to have a phone number for the facility contact in the South Coast SCAQMD. I think we're probably pretty close on this particular issue. The wording of the sign, the request is that we have instead of putting odors as the main line, that we say that it's if there's an air quality issue, and then the community wants us to include such as odors, dust, or smoke, and we're okay with including that wording in the signage. The concern from the regulated community is that this signage would generate additional odor, folks calling into the South Coast SCAQMD for odor complaints, and some of these unconfirmed odor complaints can lead to misleading information, and so there was a concern in terms of how we'd use that information, what that information could mean to a particular business. We have precedents in terms of these signage for 403, 410 for the MERS, 461 for gas stations, and so we think that it's, we're on pretty solid ground in this signage. The last key issue, and it relates to the letter that you received from Valley Forge, they had commented that the proposed rule could possibly put them out of business. We spoke to Valley Forge. They were under the impression that their facility would have to put on a total enclosure with negative air. We explained to Valley Forge that a facility that is essentially grinding in the open, and has no controls is going to see higher costs, which is the situation with Valley Forge. And so they understand that. They understand that they're going to have to step up to the plate. They're going to have to build an enclosure. That they're going to have to vent it to pollution controls. And with the understanding that their facility, which is a sufficient distance from a sensitive receptor of school, there wouldn't be subject to the requirement for a total enclosure with negative air. So it's a negative air piece for them that they were most concerned about. The cost for them, they stated, would be $250,000 to $1 million. They're closer to the $250,000, probably maybe around $350,000 in terms of their compliance costs. But once they understood the provisions of the rule, they felt more comfortable in terms of how they could comply with the rule. So this rule is will be set in February for a public hearing in March. Any questions, comments?
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Two things. One is I wanted to, I guess, encourage my fellow committee members to consider and the staff to consider revisiting the issue of the 300 versus 500 feet rule. I was a co-author of Senator Escutia's bill when we were looking at pollution for sensitive populations from freeways or busy traffic corridors, and we did adopt a 500-foot rule based on some scientific evidence about the impact. I think this is very much the same. Specifically, I'm concerned because 14 kids in the last 6 years have been diagnosed with leukemia at one elementary school that's near the Carlton Forge in Paramount. And they, you know, testing hair samples, they find chrome 6 and other metals pretty much attributable to these businesses in their hair and skin samples. So I would request the staff to revisit this issue of the 300-500. I know that it may, I don't know specifically if it puts in additional businesses. They are always going to say, we can't afford. But speaking as the safety net for healthcare in the county of Los Angeles, we can't afford it because that the sort of the cost of health concerns, it's not free. If the polluter doesn't have to take some action, then we sort of pick up the cost. The other thing is, in terms of the monitoring, which you have indicated is going to go on, especially the bag leak and the pressure drop monitoring, I wonder, and I don't know what the precedent is, but I've always found it helpful to have systematic reports to the board about the monitoring results, and I don't know whether that is automatically done or whether it's simply taken into account. I ask for some consideration about kind of a regular report on the monitoring of this particular issue. It's very sensitive for Supervisor Solis and others, you know, in the county. So for me to be able to go back and say, this is what the monitoring shows, and they reported it to the board, I think if it doesn't seem unreasonable, I think it would be very helpful. So those two things, 500 feet and reports on monitoring to the board. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And if I could, I actually have a comment directly on that 500-foot. I spent an enormous amount of effort working on those ARB land use guidance document recommendations, as well as Angela Johnson-Mazaros, who's with us today. So I immediately pulled the document up and took a look at it when you said that the 300 feet was based on that. And what it says in table 1-2 is that for risk levels between 10 and 100, they did find a significant drop-off at 300 feet. But the very next sentence says there are data limitations in both the modeling and monitoring studies. So for precautionary reason, they're recommended, there was recommendation from their resources board was 1,000 feet. And, you know, in risk levels that far exceed that we find acceptable, up to 100 and in a million. So I think that there is basis to extend that 300 foot to 500 feet, just based off this alone. It's maybe not quite as protective as we So I just wanted to talk that point specifically.
Any other board comments before we take public comment?
I did have other comments.
I figured you would.
Just, I'd also be supportive of extending that limit, 500 feet. The other thing that is concerning about this is that these industries were unregulated. And I'm wondering how that came about. What was our thinking? That these metals weren't dangerous, or we didn't know about it till chromium 6 popped up? I'm just wondering what the history of that was. Nobody jumped.
So we have colleagues at best experience, but I think, at least from what I've understood, is that we didn't realize it was a problem at the time. And then based on a lot of the information that we've obtained recently, with the extensive sampling that we've done, finding that it's something that does require our attention.
But, and I think also, the grinding at forging facilities is like, you know, there's a variety of grinding from maintenance, and maintenance type grinding is not included in this rule, to the type of grinding that's conducted at forging facilities. It's more unique at these facilities because the size of the grinders, the amount of grinding they're doing, they really can't, the pieces that they're moving for many of these facilities are so large, they can't take it to another operation. It's like it's all done there. The focus has always been on looking at the furnaces, and I think it's just, you know, a source category that we were alerted to by the community.
Yeah, I do think we have to give the community credit for bringing this to our
definitely
attention.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, the community brought the issue to our attention based on the odors. We traced it down, identified what the source, you know, was originating from. And it really kind of led to the bigger effort of expanded monitoring in the city of Paramount. So it all kind of started from that 2012, the odors and mushroomed out. So
I'll just comment. The community has been very concerned about this. The city of Paramount very concerned about this. And I want to compliment our staff because they really stepped up on this. They've had weekly telephone conference calls with the community. Every week, so the community can communicate what's happening and we can tell them what we're doing. And we've had a number of town hall meetings where, to me, it's also been very concerning to hear the stories from the members of the community, what they've experienced. And there's been a feeling in the community that we haven't done enough, that this was an urgent problem that we didn't give our full attention to. And I hope that, you know, as we have stepped up our attention to this and embark on this rulemaking, that their concerns are addressed and alleviated. The other thing that happened in this community was, well, we didn't regulate this, so we didn't know what was there. But when we began to dig in, we found there were many, many of these kinds of facilities in that community, and we found those by looking at the business licenses. We didn't find them through our own permit process. And just a lesson in that is that is another resource for us to look at, business licenses in communities, to, if we don't know what's there, we can find it through that process. So I'm very happy to see this rule come forward. It's certainly needed, and thank you to our staff for getting on this and really pursuing it with vigor and with good outreach to the community.
If I could add, we are also sharing with our other colleagues at CAPCOA and the State Air Resources Board, because we're finding through Susan's efforts on this particular rule and then also our efforts in Paramount, we're finding sources that we did not realize before could have very high toxic emissions. So it's something that we're going to share with others so that if they have the same situations, they can take a look at those as well.
Any other committee member comments? We'll come back to the committee members too. I know we have public comment on this.
I have a few things. First, on the business license review, maybe we should do that systematically and maybe start with targeting what we've identified as our most impacted communities and the cities and the county areas within those to actually systematically go through, and not only for metal facilities, but perhaps for other ones that we think might be under the radar.
So if I could just say, yeah. we're, I actually doing that right now.
Oh.
And this was in response to
we should tell your
the board direction. Well, you guys asked us to do it. We're doing it. So, the vice chair actually said there are a number of other databases.
Right.
But we've actually reached out to other cities.
Great.
As we're looking to expand. So,
so keep us informed. I mean, I'm really curious to figure this out. And this is, yeah. I mean, it's, I think, an important thing to do. We got a letter about titanium grinding and whether or not it was toxic.
It's Valley Forge.
Valley Forge, right. And our health effects officer have an opinion about that, perhaps, with the validity of that letter.
Well, so, you know, for titanium, I'm not aware of any toxicity from titanium alone. I don't know if that facility has any other emissions that are noteworthy, but specifically on titanium.
But so we have put glass plate samples around a number of forging facilities that do titanium, aluminum, titanium.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we see is the presence of a variety of different metals. And so you'll see arsenic, you'll see nickel, you'll see total chrome.
Because titanium is not just titanium.
It's not just titanium.
That's
and you'll see titanium and you'll see aluminum.
That's
but
good to
you'll,
know.
You'll see, yeah, other metals too.
But that's good to know, and it's important, and I think we need to certainly talk with the business about that issue,
right.
And make sure that they're fully informed and make sure that the board's fully informed of that, because it was the letter raised some pertinent issues. The bag houses, do most of these facilities have bag house?
There a number of them do have a bag house, but as we, you know, went to visit the facilities, our observations are the bag houses probably are not sufficient, because there was one facility that does have a bag house, and we put plate samples right outside the bag house and had collected quite a bit of particulate. So, just shows.
Do the bag houses give us an opportunity to collect data more regularly, just by having them pull a sample?
Yeah, and that's one thing we're going to use is in the rules. We're going to start taking samples of the catch, or have them. We're requiring them to take a sample of the catch.
So that's included in the rule.
Yeah.
Okay. And you talked about disincentives to prevent people from violating the rule and trying to come up with a mechanism doing it. One standard thing that all environmental regulatory agencies do is increase monitoring requirements,
mm-hmm.
as you know, people are out of compliance with the rule. I think that certainly is something that is necessary both from a enforcement standpoint, but also in terms of being more protective. And it would be a disincentive if they have a more rigorous monitoring requirements associated with violations, right?
Right. Yeah. We're thinking about that, and then what we had in the presentation that I thought was some type of a public notification or meeting or something like that seems to be,
too.
Yeah, that's a pretty strong incentive for someone to want to do the right thing. So we're thinking about it, not sure how to incorporate it, but we're thinking about it.
Couple more comments. So one of the things that we found out when we started on this problem was that we don't have authority for an immediate shutdown of a facility like this that's causing serious health impacts. So one of the things we're doing is we're going to seek some legislation, and that came to our legislative committee last week. Janice, you were there, so you understand that. That will give us that kind of immediate authority when you have this kind of specific and serious threat to human health. The other thing that I wanted to mention was that when we embarked on this problem, our staff began a very collaborative effort with LA County Health, because they do have more of that authority for immediate shutdown.
Mm-hmm.
And with DTSE, with Region 9 EPA, and brought all of those agencies in, mm-hmm. to collectively address this. I mean, one of the concerns that I think we should have is sort of can be compared to Exide, where there's a lot of soil contamination as a result of the Exide emissions. And there is that potential here as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something that, you know, DTSC would be handling, but it's something that happened as a result of these operations. And I think another concern is impact to water quality from
right.
these kinds of emissions. So maybe our staff wants to comment on that.
Sure. DTSC was actually part of the multi-agency task force that we pulled in, as was the Regional Water Quality Control Board. And DTSC, in fact, has been working with the city and I believe the schools to start collecting soil samples. They have also in the past been engaged in the community and collecting soil samples. So we're working very closely with DTSC on that very issue because of the transport dispersion and the possible settling. With regards to the water issues, water is a concern because there was actually an error in the state water quality when it was reported on chrome levels within their drinking water. And we found that through coordination with both US EPA and the state board. That has since been corrected. And subsequent to that, the city of Paramount also did additional testing. And their water is, and they're very happy to report, chrome-free. So we're very attuned to both of those issues and working with the other groups. And in addition, we've also spoken with Cal OSHA. Cal OSHA has visited these facilities. So I think if there's an agency that we haven't thought of, I would be surprised. The Coopas have been very helpful with us. LA County Department of Public Health have been our partners, were with us on court as we went forward, and we're continuing to expand that partnership across the board. And as you noted, we see these type of incidents. We're seeing the city of Bellflower that's very concerned. Our enforcement, our council and all of our operational teams have put together a plan that we're looking to expand in other areas based on characteristics that we've seen as a result of this sweep that we've recently conducted. So in terms of presenting a comprehensive strategy moving forward, maybe that's something that we can come back to this committee and provide some additional detail as to how that will be implemented, because we're also working very closely with the Air Resources Board, who's been doing a lot of the testing at the schools and has provided a lot of the resources. So it's been pretty comprehensive, and if I left anybody out, I don't think we have. But thank you.
Very good.
Mr. John.
Sure.
One more thing about the LA County Public Health, like we've been encouraging them to think kind of across a number of different platforms, because of course they're mostly concerned, primarily concerned with human health. And so we look specifically at air, water, et cetera. But there are some tangential issues when, for instance, any of these pollutants get into a water source. It's not just drinking water. It's water that, through the groundwater, feeds the trees in our public parks. Some of them are citrus trees, and we had some issues a couple of years ago with people, picking the oranges and eating them, and you're getting... sort of very indirectly, and again, it's human health, but so we're trying to take a very broad-based approach, with which often doesn't work because you've got water quality monitors, air quality monitors, and, different groups.
So we need an orange quality monitor?
We might.
You've seen that issue
you
with
wouldn't say that if you were eating those oranges.
I know. You don't want to know what's in a rotting orange. All right, any other board member comments? Public comment on this?
Mr. Chairman, I could mention that for the folks that are still standing, there's actually one more chair up here. We really can't bring in more chairs. If you prefer not to stand, there is an overflow room, room 66 just next door. Obviously, if you'd rather stay here, then that's fine.
Comments on this item? Come on down.
Since I'm standing, I'll be one of the first ones to get out of here.
Pull the chair over the table here. Sure. You have 3 minutes, and go right ahead.
Thank you. My name is Mike Pierce. I represent the W.S. Dodge Oil Company. We provide close to half of all the metalworking fluids and lubricants used in the Los Angeles Basin. Although we don't do any forging, many of our customers do. We support Rule 1430. We have participated at the working group meetings, along with our trade association, ILMA. For those such as Dr. Tassopoulos, remember on Rule 1144, we worked very, very diligently and very hard to come up with a fair and a good rule that worked well for the community and for industry. We have no problems with the rule as it's constructed. Our problem, if anything, would be going forward. These people aren't the only ones who work with high nickel, high chrome alloys. There are thousands of companies who work with those kinds of alloys. And it's not, as Steph said, there's more study needed. It's not understood clearly what all the different sources, how mechanisms for getting chrome 6 and nickel and other things into the environment are. We would just ask that we be very careful going forward that we look at what those mechanisms are so that any future controls and regulations really address the problem. Because otherwise, if you put many regulations on people, it's very hard to comply, and they may not be actually meeting the needs of the community and the workers. So that's our primary comment.
Very good. Thank you.
One last thing. We presented evidence to the laboratory testing to the staff yesterday. We will continue to work with staff in any way possible.
Thank
you.
Next speaker.
The hot seat. Okay.
There you go.
Good morning, everybody. I'm James Simonelli. I represent the California Metals Coalition. We're a statewide organization of metalworking facilities. In our public comments, we said we support the rule. We do support the rule. Susan's heard us, and we work with staff, which I do want to commend. I mean, you guys have said it as well. This is a very difficult issue, trying to trace not only the grindings, but where it's coming from. I think you've seen the tests in the city of Paramount, trying to locate where the sources are. My comments are just on two items. One is a lot of the discussion we've had, and even my discussions with community members, because I go to these, and you know, at first it's adversarial, and then you talk to them and you work together, is understanding that there's a difference between toxic and non-toxic metals. There's a difference between heavy metals and metals that are not heavy. The letter that you have in front of you from the titanium facility in terms of what they're trying to do, I know Mike, I've talked to Mike, he can comply with the rule, but not as it's currently written. And I would ask the board to look at the fact that there are toxic and non-toxic metals. And for a facility that does titanium, and when you say they capture arsenic or whatnot, that's usually a volume issue, because it's a trace metal, and if you use enough volume, it might come out. But if we look at the science of titanium, or if you know your group looks at the science of it, we believe that there should be an opportunity for, at least in the grinding rule, to separate what's toxic and what's non-toxic. And if there's the public health concern, we'll test that, we'll do whatever it is. But I've had a lot of comments from our industry members saying that I don't do nickel, I don't do chrome, I don't do arsenic, I don't bring these things into my facility. And you know, if you're sitting there in the center of Paramount and you're getting arsenic on your roof, it could be your neighbor. And to write a rule that says it's coming out of your shop, we know it's coming out of your shop, we just ask to stop and at least let some science fill in with the gaps if we know the fact that we're starting out bringing into the facility aluminum, iron, titanium, non-toxic metals. So that's basically the comment. I want to continue working. If this goes to the board on March 3rd, we'll be there in support of moving things forward. As Mike has said, you guys are just scratching the surface. You know, you're talking about 22 metal facilities under this. We estimate roughly 20,000. And you have to understand, ports, I mean, how do you fix all the containers and all of the ships out there? The ports, this building, when they built it, how do you think they got all the metal into place and the gears into place? Every construction site, Caltrans, every road that they work on, how do you think they put the roads together? So as you go out and regulate all of those things, including us, keep in mind that you're setting the pace for what you want all of these entities to do. So I'll stop there. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Sure.
I just want to ask staff to comment on that. Is there a reason or a way to differentiate the non-toxic metals from toxic in the rule? Would that even be useful? Joe said to me, do you want to be breathing any kind of metal? I don't, but I think that's a legitimate issue to raise here.
Well, I think the challenge, is Mr. Spinelli?
Yeah.
Said was the you have trace materials present, and you know you've seen that in other types of industries where let's just say it was lead, where you see
we had
arsenic, you had antimony, you had other materials. There are things that you could possibly do in terms of potential source testing on every single aspect, and you could maybe go through some measure. I'd have to check with staff in terms of what might be feasible. But I think that what we have is, we have a network of monitors. We're deploying even further monitors, and we're seeing these kind of materials come up. And we're aware of upwind contribution. We're certainly looking at all those variations that impact the readings. But I think that based on what we have right now, and I think that you're going to find more and more information is going to be garnered. One of the things that's happening as a result of Paramount is that the local city now wants to have additional monitoring network just for that city. And they've also authorized the acquisition of $50,000 worth of monitoring equipment. And they're looking
that
they're to us. They're paying for it. And that's a question that the legislature has asked us, should the city be doing that, or should there be increased funding provided to the district so that it can increase the monitoring networks within these cities? And that's something that we can evaluate, and we have to do that in conjunction with the city. But right now, at least in Paramount, you're seeing a desire for specific monitors within the city dedicated to that city.
For metals.
But it's, as you know, a slippery slope, because you can focus on hex chrome, but as has been raised, there may be others, so maybe you look at total metals. And then other cities, as we're expanding the sampling, say, well, if they have that, maybe perhaps that's something that we want to have. And so it gets into an expanded network that complements and enhances the MATES data that we currently have, and then it deals with all the data acquisition and data interpretation and all the challenges that go into maintaining that network that we expend a lot of resources on. So it's a challenge. We're sort of at the forefront of that very issue, not only just from a technical perspective, but also from a hardware perspective, an analytical perspective.
But local cities and counties are interested in doing their own monitoring. We certainly could provide, you know, a little bit of effort of our expertise to advise them on how to do it the right way. And what's involved, I think, it's a big wake-up call when you realize, oh, you can't measure, you know, metals the same way you do particulate matter, with the way that you measure VOCs, or let alone semi-volatile VOCs, or dioxin, or furans, and you know, I mean, they're going to have questions about all this stuff, and we are certainly a great resource for them to learn about.
We serve as that resource. As you well know, the challenge is what happens when a device becomes uncalibrated or is not properly maintained.
And they should be warned about
that
too,
and you get readouts that aren't correct, and then you have information that may not be valid. I mean, these are all the kind of concerns that we have with the expansion of these low-cost networks. How do you communicate? And when someone is given a piece of paper that shows a spike or an elevated reading, you know, our staff would take a very jaundiced eye. They'd want to look at all the parameters that went into that, whereas somebody else might say, are you kidding me? There's a spike there. What are you going to do about it? And so we have to develop a much more comprehensive education program. And in fact, Lockie and Matt and Jason and Dr. Polidori and others are working on that through a STAR grant. And we're working on that in conjunction with other districts through the state. So this challenge is one that is on everyone's mind. We're at the forefront in trying to address those challenges. We will be having the data that Mr. Spinelli asked. Could you go more aggressive? Could you do things? There's always that kind of debate that we're having internally, but we'll certainly consider what those options might be and then bring it back before the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Do we have a way of identifying gaps, maybe I should ask Joe Kay, in health impact studies? I mean, many times we'll hear from industries, well, you know, this isn't really dangerous, and there haven't been sufficient validated studies on a particular kind of pollutant and the impact on human health. And I don't know whether we fund such things or partner with others in doing them, but throughout the last several decades, we've always heard from industries, you know, no harm, no foul, no And then 10 years later, you discover, you know, a cancer cluster nearby, and oh, it was related. So I'm just thinking of whether there's some way that we identify those gaps, especially if we might be looking at business licenses, you know, in an area. I mean, 1/10 of LA County is unincorporated, so we're the municipal government. We're wanting to look at our business licenses and try to identify kinds of industries that we actually have there, which we're engaging in now. But I don't know whether we have a way to tie those industries to health impacts.
Well, and Joe Kay can add to this, and so can staff. I would say that the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry, ATSDR, is probably one of the most definitive sources when it comes to impacts. EPA utilizes their own toxics registry in combination with ATSDR. But I think in terms of just a broad-based industry, Joe Kay, are you familiar with any?
I don't know about, you know, specific to industry, but, you know, in terms of like scientific assessment of, you know, the health effects of any particular chemical, you know, I know, you know, for ATSDR or OEHA, you know, part of the assessment obviously is the adequacy of the data. Mm-hmm. And, you know, obviously sometimes, you know, the assessment turns out that there's just inadequate data to make any kind of conclusion or any definitive conclusion, or there's a lot of uncertainty in that conclusion. Sometimes that is the case, and other times that there is sufficient data, obviously they can perhaps do a more complete assessment and provide a more definitive result. So, you know, certainly the adequacy of the data is can be an issue in some circumstances.
And maybe Phil first and then Lockie.
I just wanted to add, one of your questions was, do we fund health studies? And we do fund health studies, and we have over the past 10, 20 years. In the past, at least, they tend to focus on, like, the criteria of pollutant effects, particulate matter, ozone, and trying to maybe tease out some
really
of the
good ultrafine.
Ultrafines and ultrafines. So we try to, a lot of those have been directed at looking what the health impacts locally and in the basin are, but also trying to tease out the different sources of particulate matter that might be leading to those health effects. But we haven't done a lot on specific toxics or toxics for which there may be insufficient evidence in trying to fill the gap. So that is a great suggestion.
And I was going to say, you know, you're raising a very good point. Unfortunately, the difficulty that we are in is out of the hundreds of thousands of different chemicals, metals, toxins, non-toxins that are out there, only a very small subset, a tiny thing, sliver, if you will, is the subset that we have some information on regarding toxicity. For the vast majority, there's nothing out there.
Yet we do risk assessments and trust those numbers.
If I could just add, Supervisor, that you know, one of the things I would say that I think we've learned from the City of Paramount, the city provided us with a listing of nearly 80 facilities. At the time, we had 14 facilities, as I recall, that were actually permitted that we knew about. And what we have to be careful about is sometimes the names are misleading. So, you know, we actually had a few facilities that, all they may have said grinding or machining or something like that, when we visited, they had nothing to do with metal. In fact, one of them was grains and oats, as I recall.
Right.
So when we look at these databases, we have to be very careful. And I think that's something, though, that we might be able to talk with LA County Department of Public Health, is how could we do that sort of high-level review of city business licenses with our existing database of licenses, and then sort of look at that subset of what's been left behind. And that's actually something that we're trying to do in our own effort as we move out, and that's part of what the plan that we're developing that we hope to bring back before you goes through.
We were in the middle of public comment.
Yes, any other public comment members?
Sorry.
Well,
are we
going to come on down?
Yeah, I'm Harvey Yetter with the Public Solar Power Coalition. Under this hex chromium, I don't know if I'm mistaken, but didn't it start with Aaron Brockovich in the movie? Okay, well.
It anyway. Started with her, but she certainly had an impact on that conversation.
We always think of Aaron Brockovich.
I don't know if there's anything we could learn here for the future. Looking for movies like this or something. And see problems with any of
them. There was a big data gap there.
Yeah.
The issue there actually was the difference between inhalation toxicity of hexavalent chromium and ingestion toxicity of hexavalent chromium, which has been a very big issue.
Any other public comment? Going once, going twice. All right, bring it back to the yes. So we're going to go a little out of order and go to item number five, which is the update on implementation of Rule 111. Sorry, Rule 1111. And we're going to go to that, Tracy.
Yes, sir. And granted that we're running out of time, I do know we have some people here that want to testify and come from out of state. I'll go through these quickly. Rule 1111 applies to residential, commercial, natural gas, central furnaces, regulates manufacturers and distributors. It was SIP approved in March of 2016. In 2010, staff did a demonstration project looking at the feasibility and the commercialization of products that would be able to meet the rule limit of 14 nanograms per joule. We had four contracts that went out. What they did is they took units and they retrofitted with burner systems. All four of those met the 14 nanograms per joule requirement. One did have some safety concerns, but as we move forward, we did amend the rule in September of 2014 to delay the compliance date and allow for the submission of a mitigation fee in lieu to get three additional years to develop their products and commercialize them. This slide just is a representation of what the mitigation fees are for the different units and the amount of time that they were granted. April 2018 is the earliest compliance date that's going to be coming forward. All of the manufacturers chose to use the mitigation fee option. We did meet with stakeholders looking at revising the emission limits. We did have a request back in April of 2016 that asked staff to, take another look. We're having trouble developing products. They were asking us to look at the emission limit, maybe delay the compliance date, look at the mitigation fee. So we began collecting information and actually met confidentially because, as you might imagine, manufacturers don't want to share their data. We met confidentially with a number of the manufacturers. So we met with eight manufacturers and two burner manufacturers. That included Lennox, Johnson Controls, Rheem, Carrier, Goodman, and Nortec, and then the burner manufacturers, Lantec and Beckett Gas. Right now, we do have one standard unit by Rheem that has been certified to meet the 14 nanograms per joule. We do have four ultra-low-NOx burner technologies that are available for license to the different manufacturers. But as you can imagine, the manufacturers are not only looking at our market, they're looking at other markets as well. Due to this, and we know that manufacturers have been doing testing over the winter months, we know that there's some product development that's ongoing right now. Given the fact that we have one certified unit, and Rheem's going to certify more units, there's also a trade show coming up in June where we understand from the trade association that there's going to be some more compliant products potentially being demonstrated. Our recommendation is to kind of hold off at this time, looking and recommending, pursuing amendments to Rule 1111 for 6 months, so we can see how the product development unfolds. And if it looks like we do need to go back in, maybe for weatherized units or non-condensing units, we need to allow some more time, we can start doing that. So with that, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Any board member questions? We had
a letter that suggested that our testing method wasn't comprehensive.
Well, I do believe our testing method is comprehensive. I know that they had concerns about the startup emissions that are associated with that. When I asked the manufacturer what kind of burner system they used, was it their own? Did they go out and buy one? They couldn't tell me, or wouldn't tell me, but they weren't able to tell me. But I do want to say that the Rheem technology is compliant through the entire process, through the entire firing cycle.
Even with the startup?
Yes, ma'am.
We've run across this issue with heavy-duty trucks working at our ports.
Yes, sir.
So. Yeah. I don't want to be on our end of it messing it up.
So we just want to
on the stationary sources that we read.
Yeah, so we just want to take a little time, and we'll continue talking with the manufacturers and the stakeholders. And if it looks like we need to do something, we'll staff will get together with executive management and we'll of course have a plan.
Okay. Public comment on this? Harvey, you want to go first? Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Mark Harvey Yetter with Public Solar Power Coalition. 3, 4, 5 years ago, this rule was coming up kind of tangentially, and we came in and wanted solar to be evaluated, and it was looked at. I think there was something lacking on the evaluation, and followed through also to the Environmental Protection Agency. Anyway, this is an example of where, you know, solar can be used for space heating and cooling. And there's also district heating and cooling. And we've put into the record in our recent exhibits systems in Europe for solar district heating systems and large storage systems, seasonal storage systems. So this is part of what we're discussing with staff. Solar conversion. We need total solar conversion. So anyway, this should be continued now in the evaluations.
Thank you. Further public comment? Come on down.
Got some presentations to hand out.
Okay.
Let me know who needs a copy.
Just here. Go ahead and introduce yourself and go ahead.
Hello, everyone. I'm Karen Myers, and I'm in charge of all the regulatory, legislative, and public affairs matters for REAM. And first of all, I want to give you a little bit of our history. Not only do we have products that currently comply with the rule, but we have also had a lot of low NOx technologies. We built water heaters, small boilers, pool heaters. We even have a lab that is South Coast approved in our Montgomery, Alabama facility. So we have a long history of working with you guys and developing low NOx technologies. I do have to point out that there is a slide in our presentation that we are required to show from our legal department that says that this information is confidential. But specifically to Rule 1111, it has it covers three types of furnaces: condensing, non-condensing, and residential and weatherized furnaces. We do have, we're very proud to have one model that is has been approved by South Coast, and we are preparing to go into field test with that next week, as a matter of fact. We our field test is, and we've been out here earlier this week training contractors on that product. So we are certified to the 14 nanograms per joule. We're very excited about this technology and quite proud of all the development work that has gone into this. I will tell you that the furnace is different than the traditional furnaces, but different should not be construed as more complicated or more complex. It is simply different and quite reliable and safe to operate. So we have been training HVAC contractors. They get it when we walk them through how the product works, and we're very excited to move forward with this product. It has also been certified by CSA as well as several third-party consultants. I'm going to bring up our marketing and field lead to talk about what we're doing and explain more on the field test. One thing I do want to bring to your attention is I know you are scheduled to review this rule in the next 6 months. It is a multi-million dollar investment for this technology. So we're kind of waiting on you to see what's going to happen with Rule 1111 before we move forward. The tooling has a 52-week lead time, and then there's the whole matter of commissioning the tooling and getting it market ready. And then there's a lot of training that has to go on as well. One of the things we've noticed in our current training is that we think that training needs to go beyond typical technician training and go forward to touch all people who might interact with the product, including building inspectors and utility folks as well. We had some very positive conversation with those people about willing to engage and partnering with us on that technology. So we're excited, but before we can move forward, we need you guys to kind of solidify what's going to go forward. And when you guys have done that, we will go forward and secure the investment that we need to really make this a product that's, which we feel is going to be great for the district here in California. So with that, I'd like to bring up our marketing guy, who's been the face going.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, absolutely.
Before you bring him up. I mean, first, I just like to say thank you for making that investment. And mm-hmm. I know it must not have been easy, but you've done it, and so congratulations. The question I guess I would have would be, you know, is there a huge cost differential for the product that you're going to be developing? I know that you've sunk a lot of research development and now the tooling cost mm-hmm. into it, so you have to recover those at some point. But it makes a difference to us, you know, whether people who can't afford, you know, basically just to replace their existing heaters, whether they're going to, now we're putting them in a situation where they have to buy something that's going to be tremendously more expensive. And I'm also presuming that we might have some discomfort if you are the only game in town because you would have a monopoly. And even though, you know, I'm sure you wouldn't do this to people in the South Coast Air Basin, you would have the opportunity to raise the price and command have a monopoly over the market. So the question really is, what is the price going to be competitive? And, you know, what's the differential there?
So I'm going to defer that question to the
you
guys, actually, so, yeah, to our marketing guy. But I will tell you that our technology, it can be licensed to other, and we think it would be a great idea to even extend the mitigation fee to allow others mm-hmm. to, you know, catch up. You know, it's not our intent to push this forward as a competitive advantage. But we do want to move forward with a very viable technology that we think meets the requirements of Rule 1111, but the technology can be licensed, and if the board found it acceptable to extend the mitigation period, we think that's an acceptable path forward as well.
Thank you for being a leader on this.
Before we go on, I think your attorney Paige has excited our attorney. So
I kind of thought the same thing to myself. Yeah. Like, there's nothing in here that needs
to talk to those lawyers.
Okay.
I'll
and
take
with that,
it is fine. Okay. It is fine.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Terry Stern. I'm the project manager for residential gas furnaces for REAM. We came out the board meeting in December to try to do a presentation to the board to show our product. Unfortunately, the board wasn't able, but we did present to the staff. We actually commissioned the product, tested it, ran it outside your outside facility. We are at the 14 or less requirement. From that point back, we spent 2 weeks here in California in December. We spent 1 week in South Coast Market, going talking to our distributors and contractors and educating them on the product, kind of giving them the overall timeline of what was going on, potentially the rule would change. We spent the next week in the San Joaquin Valley doing the same thing. Came back for the January board meeting. We made public record to notify that we do have a product. We're going to start a field test. We're willing to license that technology. We are not going to move forward, as Karen said, on anything from a capital expenditure until we know what's going on with the rule. We are going to be starting our first field test next week, first installs next week. The first two arcs are going to be in the San Joaquin Valley. We've got 10 to 15 more slated as we're working with our
contract. All the South Coast Air Basin, right?
Combination of both. We've got to make sure we got them in both markets to test.
You need a weatherized test location? I've got a house.
That'll be coming. So with the field test.
I'm looking
test,
forward to
yes.
buying this.
Yeah, with the field test, we want to make sure we go a full year cycle. So through the full winter and a full summer, because you know, you never know with product. We found out through our initial conversation, we've made some very good contacts with some utilities. There's a lot more training that Karen mentioned, not only training our HVAC contractors and distributors on the product, mm-hmm. because there are some nuances to the product to make sure it's installed properly. Again, different's not scary different, mm-hmm. but it is a different product than what they're used to today. SoCal Gas does have test facilities that they're willing to help us with. They also have mobile test units. So as we go and have these field installs done, we can basically go out every quarter and test the NOx emissions and how they're going through life cycle. We've also learned, you know, again, with building code officials, inspectors, there's a lot of things they're going to need because they're going to see something that's going to be different. It's going to alarm them. And, of course, they approve any appliances that are put into a home. So there's a lot of training education that needs to be done there, and also with the cert training. So there's a lot that has to be done. So what we're proposing is keep the rule in place. Once you make your decision, we can make a decision on capital. We would like additional time for the other manufacturers to catch up because certain times you don't want to have a monopoly and when it comes to regulatory items, you don't, especially we know in the future there's alternate refrigerants that are in play. And you know, we don't want to be blocked out of that. So we are allowing and willing for everybody to catch up. We will license our technology to any other OEM that can't get there. It will take them time to apply our technology. And so we think that mitigation period extension will allow that plus additional training that we have to do.
Thank you, Justin.
Yes, go
ahead. So where is San Joaquin Valley and their rulemaking on this?
They were following you?
Okay.
So you guys set the rule they're following. So they're on the same timeline, but they did change, their mitigation fees are higher. So they're charging $290 for condensing and $250 for non-condensing.
A lot of their fees are higher.
They're all about money.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time.
Any other public comment on this item? Going once, going twice.
Oh.
No, you already had
your headset, buddy.
You went first.
Mr. Chairman.
You went first.
Go ahead. I could suggest going to item number four.
Okay. Any other comments on this item from the board members? Not hearing any. We'll go to item number four. Update on proposed rules 1304. Tracy again.
I'm just going to kind of cut to the chase. In September, we had brought an update to the governing board, or I'm sorry, to this committee. And at the Riverside October board meeting in Riverside, during public comment, concerns were raised about staff pursuing the development of these two rules. And Dr. Liu also, expressed concerns that are we going somewhere where we don't need to go, whether or not the offsets are really needed to come from the agency or were they available publicly, and getting into that actual need. But let me just kind of cut through to, you know, at first we started pursuing these rules because it seemed like there was a need. We're going to need additional power generation for grid reliability. There was also a concern that there were not enough offsets available on the open market. And we had two project proponents, one for each rule, Stanton Energy Reliability Center for 1304.2 in the city of Glendale for 1304.3. But since the October board meeting, we have received some additional information we wanted to share with the committee. The Stanton project has submitted their permits. They submitted them on November 2nd. They're looking at two peaking units totaling 98 megawatts each one, having 10 megawatts of battery storage. They are proposing to not go to the open market. They're proposing to stay below the 4-ton limit. So they would not need to go to the open market. Their applications were deemed incomplete. We have received additional information. Staff is reviewing that. But at this time, it looks like they're shooting to avoid offset purchases. For Glendale, they have come in and spoken with staff. They have not submitted applications. However, they do have several different options that they're looking at. Depending on what those options are, there's varying amounts of offsets that they may need. But again, they're going to look to minimize the necessary amount of offsets that they're purchasing. Given this information and given the fact that the need for additional generation doesn't seem to be there like it was previously, we're recommending that we suspend rulemaking for the moment and see how these projects develop and really find out whether or not there's going to be a need for these rules. Is that, Mr. Chair?
All right. Any board member comments before public comment?
I just want to say I told you so, but I'm fine.
You heard it. You got it.
Had to say it.
Harvey, you have a comment?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll take that coffee with you.
First of all, before I forget, there was a paper done out by us in UC Riverside. I tried to get it on the record. I'm not sure if it's in yet, but I mentioned to the board. With a 100 megawatt GE turbine, going through the turbine, they had a filter PM 0.3, and everything went right through that filter. So you got a big problem with natural gas in particulate, and that's deaths at $9 million premature per. Okay, put into the record was the Sunshot new documents from May of this year. Included was concentrating solar power. Also in the IPER from March, I'm not sure if it was March or May of this year, Dr. Jacobson at Stanford testified and said that it's less expensive now for concentrating solar power with storage than natural gas peakers. So that's the real world right now. It's in the record. You've got to use the best science, which is the best evidence, and that's all she wrote. Are there any questions? No.
Any questions?
No. Thank you. Come on down.
I guess we're at good afternoon now. Good morning. It's a great sunny Southern Oh. I'm Angela Johnson Mazaros with Earth Justice, and I was at the meeting in October, and there I raised two concerns. One was the knee question, and I'll just echo what Dr. Lou just said. And then the second concern was the signal that this board is sending to energy providers in the region by holding open the opportunity to access these offsets. So what we know is that every day, every month, we get more and more information about available alternatives to fossil fuel energy. And we see that being embraced by the IOUs, and we see it being embraced somewhat by the RFPs, the POUs. So while we have this moment in time when there's not pressure to think about whether or not there's dangers for our energy system, I really urge the board to consider sending a strong and serious message that new fossil fuel energy is not something that this basin can accommodate. As you all know, you'll be hearing an item that comes with it, a request to not only tax people in the region, but to make a Herculean effort to get to our air quality standards, and to simultaneously not be clear that on those pollution sources that we can avoid, like fossil fuel energy power stations, you're going to stand strong and insist that we shift this basin to a clean energy future. So I just wanted to urge you to, instead of suspending the rule, to direct staff to not continue to work on this rule and to send a clear message that you're not going to be supporting the more fossil fuel energy in the basin.
Now, those comments remind me that I got an email this week inviting me to the ribbon-cutting grand opening of a 20-megawatt battery storage facility in Pomona, right? Next week, right? You guys see that?
Yep.
From Edison?
No, it was from the company, Alta Gas.
Yeah, but Edison contracted them for 10 years, and I spent, $45 million or something like that.
But, yeah, 20 megawatts of battery storage electricity right around the corner here.
From solar? From what?
No, it's just batteries.
It's just storage.
But it comes from whatever's on the grid. They store it.
So from the grid. Okay.
Yeah, which is now probably getting closer to 30% renewable.
Exactly. And I think that the fact of the matter is that it is this offset bank that really supports a notion that fossil can be cost effective. Right, they had to go out to the market if they had to actually pay the cost that the market would demand in order to get those offsets. It would clearly make it not cost effective. So it is this bank and access to this bank that allows some marginal projects to think that they can be cost effective competing against clean renewables that can provide the exact same reliability requirements for our energy grid. Storage, solar and storage, storage on existing fossil, right? There are so many different opportunities that we have and more every day. So I would, again, I just urge this board to consider what it means to say, to signal that we're going to ensure, in effect, that fossil stays cost competitive in this case.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other
Morning. I'm Carl Laney with the Montrose Environmental Group, back here with the City of Glendale Department of Water and Power. Tracy indicated that a lot of information has become known since he last spoke with you in October. Clearly, that's true. In our particular case, we have selected a project. We have contracted with specific equipment vendors, and we are proceeding with our project. As district staff members, we've been through the notice of, we've issued our notice of preparation for CEQA. We are now finishing our environmental analysis, and we will be coming to the district with permit applications in April, and also proceeding with our CEQA process in March.
You will need offsets.
We will need offsets. I want to point out a couple of things, and the first of which is this particular rule that is being proposed does not allow us to avoid the cost of offsets. We're not trying to find shelter from cost. We're trying to make sure that a viable and necessary project, and I'll talk about that in a second, can indeed be fulfilled. That's all we want. We're trying to protect ourselves from an illiquid, non-fluid market where there's not a lot of pricing transparency. Okay. As far as the need of the project or the need for the project goes, the city has conducted an exhaustive analysis, and people who are familiar with municipalities and how they operate their utilities, I think, recognize that they have to go through a planning process that's a long-term plan. The application that the district will be seeing is the result of that plan. That reflects our growing dependence on renewable energy. It reflects the infrastructure limitations we have. It reflects the need to provide reliable power to the community, and it reflects the commitments we have with the neighboring communities so that we don't become dependent on them. So from our perspective, I want to make sure that the district understands objectively this project is necessary. It helps support renewables, and it helps us support the removal of aging generating assets, not only in the district but outside the district. We were also very happy to learn that the Stanton project would not become the drain on the market that we were afraid it would become. And because of that, we also understand why staff would suggest putting this temporarily on hold until more information is known about my project. And I certainly can't contest that. What I must do, though, is ask that the district do nothing more than that, temporarily suspend it, maintain communication with us, wait until our application comes in April, give us the opportunity to work more with the brokers in the market to make sure that the market can indeed serve our needs.
Okay, we will keep that door open.
When we get to the point of having to decide whether to make credits available, can staff provide to us what the cost would be if the facility purchased those credits on the open market? And then explain to me why we would subsidize that by providing them credits for less. That's what I would want to know. I'm open to the possibility that the credits may not exist. I'm also curious as to why we would set a price anything below what the market would demand. And I mean, you know, I know that this offset system doesn't work as perfectly as envisioned when it was first proposed. But there's some issues here that
if I may, Dr. Blue, right now, the way the rules are being structured, we're going to use the same price level, which is Rule 13.4.1. And our understanding is
that, if I remember correctly, it was about $82,000.
Mm-hmm. Right. And right now, that is more expensive than what we're aware of is available on the market. So,
really?
Yes.
The last report I saw about 150.
Can I very quickly? You're correct. You know what you just said. It's a very liquid market, which means the prices can fluctuate depending on the demand and supply. When we established the 13.4.2 price, it was a weighted average over an extended period of time. I remember, was it 3 years, 5 years? I can't remember.
I remember it was 3 or 5 years.
Something like that. Mm-hmm. So it reflects the fluctuation. And at any given time,
many years ago.
Many years ago, sure. And for the new rule, I think, you know, it's a fair game to take another look at that fluctuation and perhaps establish a new price.
Mm-hmm. Do we know at this point how many other utilities might come to us looking for offsets?
For these two rules, these are the only projects that we're aware of. Yes, please.
I want to make, also, I did not point this out, but that is another level of concern that we have at the city. Certainly as a municipality, being able to get a project through takes longer than it does someone in the private sector, being able to get the final approvals will be going through POD, and we're moving ahead with all of that. One of the other things that we don't know about,
pardon? You don't have to fight with the PDC.
We have other people. One of the things we don't know, and I don't think the district knows either, is what will be the impact of the reclaim on the market that we have to participate in. But we don't know that impact. We don't know whether the utilities will come out of reclaim and actually have a project that they're going to mitigate through the ERC market. We don't know how, if the district does subset reclaim, how they're going to manage the equity between reclaim and Regulation 13. Those are unknowns. And from our perspective, those unknowns also support the concept of keeping this rule available to us should we continue to see the need.
That's a good point that staff needs to, we need to be working on.
Thank you.
Any other public comments on this one?
I want to think that you should have the speaker here so it could be heard on the record. I mean, it should be a microphone.
There's one here. Yeah.
Well, we have microphones everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we got this.
Damnation here.
All right. Any other board member comments on this item?
No.
All right. Very good. Thank you. Please let the minutes reflect that it's not that I can't count. We are now on item 3 of 5. This is what staff has asked us to sort of take this in a different order. But okay, so now we're on the status report, rule 1147. And again, Tracy.
Yeah, and I'm going to probably hopefully be even quicker on this. For rule 1147, it was adopted in 2008. It was later amended to allow a 5-year extension for sources that would have technical and financial difficulty meeting the standards. Those in particular are those less than a pound per day. Staff committed and over the last few years has conducted a technology assessment. That technology assessment took into account a myriad of data. This represents the 5 recommendations that came out of that. Those recommendations really reflect staff's acknowledgement of the technical and cost issues that are facing industry. Each of these actually represents a relief from the rule requirements. As committed to, we did do a contract with ETS to do a third-party review of the tech assessment. They looked at all the same data that staff did. They agreed with staff's recommendations. In fact, they added a 6th recommendation that we agreed to. Also would represent relief with respect to the industry. This gets into the cost. They did agree with us on the cost, and they also recognize the cost issues that are facing the industry. This gets into what the impacts of the moving forward with amending the rule to implement these recommendations. It affects 4,900 small and low emission units, 3,400 spray booths, and other equipment, 1,500 small ovens. It does represent a 0.6 to 0.9 ton per day, roughly about 0.7 foregone NOx emission reductions. However, I should point out that these units will be going and being and overturning and be upgrading or replacing their equipment over the next 20 years. So we will get those emission reductions.
Yeah, how do we factor that in? I mean, just those reductions do happen because of NSR, but it's going to take perhaps.
But as they go through, longer. Because what our recommendation is, because of the technical issues associated with that, and in part also cost, we're saying that they won't have to make those meet those new emission limits until they do a refurbishment or replace the equipment. And then there are some other equipment that were not affected, but they're older and they're already in compliance. The task force that we've worked with. In general, they're in agreement with these. Of course, we're providing relief to the industry. There are some recommendations that we're going to work with them on as we proceed with rulemaking, trying to do more with maintenance costs because as these equipments survive longer, there are other maintenance issues that may come into play as opposed to a unit that might only last 10 years versus 25 years. Looking at other ways to ascertain the 1 pound per day criteria, because if they're less than 1 pound per day, the record keeping requirements, some things can be different. There is concern that we don't do anything to impact the permit backlog. And then one of the other elements is since we're dealing with a lot of small companies, a lot of them are not very savvy. So we're going to work with the industry to develop compliance guidelines and information to help them comply with the rules and regulations. With that, we're going to finalize the technology assessment with ETS recommendations. We're going to continue our meetings. We're proceeding with rulemaking. We had a meeting on Tuesday. Our NOP is actually going to go out February 1st because of work that staff is doing on the AQMP, finalizing that. And we're looking at May-June timeframe to bring that amendment to the board as that five-year extension kicks in July 1st, and we need to make the amendment before that.
Very good. Board member comments?
Yes, ma'am.
Tracy, there were a couple of kind of optional things that weren't in the list of five that had to do with, if I'm not mistaken, spray booths that had multiple booths, and I don't know whether there was a decision about whether to pursue that, where might have considered those with multiple booths separate from locations that just had, you know, one booth or single booths.
Well, some of the booths, when it comes to demonstrating their emission levels, they may need to be retrofitted with fuel meters or timers so that they can be looked at individually.
So was that included in what you suggested going forward? You just said there were kind of five recommendations, and it seemed to me these were, and we could also.
Yeah, if I could ask Gary Quinn, who's in charge of that.
Yeah, this would be one of the things that we'll be working with the regulated community as we go through rulemaking. We have not taken that off the table.
Good, because I think it's a good idea to look at the
sure.
sort of the multiple booth issue. Where, you know, multiple, it's the aggregate effect again, the kind of multiple small units taken together. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Thank you. Any public comment on this item?
Thank you. My name is Paul Engel. I'm a consultant for Handbill Printers, who will be speaking after me here. They operate a facility in Corona. This facility has very minimal gas usage and produces less than a ton of NOx per year, even based on the default factor of 130 pounds of NOx per million cubic feet. They have two presses. Two of their three presses are low NOx. Handbill is in the process of installing a gas meter on this third press to demonstrate that it is less than a pound a day of NOx. If it is not less than a pound a day, Handbill will manage its operations such that the gas usage would be less than 300,000 cubic feet per month. This press operates 24/7, so that is why it is different than the currently envisioned number. To install low NOx burners on this press would be $25,000 per burner. This would bring the cost of the dollars per ton reduced, if we did go to low NOx burners, to greater than $50,000 per ton. The district would be punishing a longstanding permittee for moving and staying within the district if there was no alternative, and it would be, you know, minimal NOx emissions. And I could provide you with the handout.
Thank you.
Well, I want to thank you for listening to me today. My name is Mark Messick. I'm one of the owners of Handbill Printers. Handbill Printers is a family-owned company, father and four sons, of which I'm one of the four sons. We've been in business since 1984, and at one point had grown to 240 employees. But when 2007, 2008, when the economy failed us, we are now down to 43. We have been struggling since that time to stay in business, to be a factor in the market, and it has been a real struggle, financially especially. About 3 years ago, we were actually forced out of our building in Garden Grove and forced to find other facilities, which we found in Corona. And that move itself cost us over $1 million to do, which further just put us down in the hole, and we've been struggling to come up from that. As Paul mentioned, we do have two of our three presses. We're down to just the three. Are in compliance. This other one, the burners were permitted back when we got them back in the mid-late 90s, and we're in compliance at that time. So if we have to retrofit these burners, not only would it be, you know, we would not be able to afford to do that, then what happens is we have to shut down that press, which then further causes more layoffs, loss of revenue for us, and personally, I don't think we could survive that at all.
So one of the questions, that, I mean, or issues that, that Tracy brought up was that eventually, you know, everybody replaces their equipment. How long before you replace equipment that you bought in the 1990s?
Well, once we get out of this hole, we're hoping to be able to do that. Yeah, it's like I said, we were a very strong force in the industry at one time, and through the no fault of our own, the economy failed, and you know, most of our business went away, and we've been struggling trying to get that back.
When you get that new equipment, it'll be a lot cleaner, I guarantee.
Oh yeah, it definitely will be. But as Paul mentioned, if we can get this meter on there, and and to show this one press itself, it's got the two ovens, half of it rarely runs. It's like two units that merge together. And then, like I said, we're only running, in fact, half of it hasn't even run for 3 months. So we're well below, even with both running, we're still below the 1 pound a day. So that's kind of where we're at. And we're
thanks for letting us know.
We're hoping to get some help from you guys. So, thank you very much.
Let's take a look at that.
Yes, no, we will. Tracy, we will. We'll go with them and have a meeting with them and get more into the issue.
Good. Yeah. Good. Any other public comment?
Good morning. My name is Tony Andrus, president of Furnace Dynamics. I want to commend the staff for embarking on a rule modification. This is a very well-warranted change. We've worked with staff on this 1147 since 2008, so we've been there for a long time. With regard to the ETS study, we have a lot of questions and concerns about how it was done. I'll pass out some of my comments. Staff already has these comments. And basically, the ETS looked at all the stuff that the staff provided and accepted the majority of those issues from staff. However, in their results, they downplayed a lot of the issues that were presented by industry. I conducted probably the majority of the comments into ETS. And if you read the story, read the text, you'll find that there were a lot of issues that were diminished in importance, which were unfounded. One of the most critical issues was a study that I did on crest coatings. Crest coatings is a powder coating operation. It's the most definitive and comprehensive cost-effectiveness evaluation ever done at 1147 facility. I conducted pre-testing to find out how many devices would be compliant. The pre-testing showed only one device in their plant. Everything else had to be retrofitted. We also did parallel testing with SourceTest beforehand. We did previous preliminary testing, which is provided in here. ETS did not provide any of the data that we submitted to them as part of their report, which is, to our extent, our feeling, it's a grievous omission. The concern that we had, when you review this, you'll see it's a rather significant amount of documentation. It looks at all the pre-testing that was done. It looks at the costs that were involved, and the total cost of the plant was around $300,000 to modify their furnaces. I had included source test data, and I have included also cost-effectiveness considerations. And the cost-effectiveness are based on the BTU inputs during the tests for in hours of operation. The cost-effectiveness takes into all these into consideration, and the devices operate differently. And when you see the spreadsheets of cost, you'll find that even with similar devices, the cost to install and modify the equipment is dramatic. The cost effectiveness for this facility ran from the lowest was $30,000 per control ton. The highest was $499,000 per control ton. So we wanted to make sure that this information was provided It has been provided to staff, 1147 staff. So it's important that other folks have an understanding of a solid, beneficial cost effectiveness on a specific facility. And the other consideration is that the people that submitted the information to ETS represents about 150 years of experience in the field. I've been working with combustion systems from 1971. I've designed and engineered recuperators for saving energy on forge and heat treat furnaces. I've designed and engineered forge and heat treat furnaces. I've conducted over 200 pretests for 1147 and parallel tested around 75 source tests. I'm typically within around 2 ppm of official source test data. So the information that we have submitted, it was as best we could figure out accurate. And it correlates when I pretest or parallel test. The data that I can wind up with is, like I said, within 2 ppm. The best that I've done is 0.14 parts per million for the duration of the test period. So the information that was presented to ETS, we felt was accurate as a starting point, so you can look at the comparison between the starting point and the ending point. So, any?
This is our favorite rule, as you know.
Oh, it's been my favorite rule for years.
Yeah, you love business.
Yeah, it's my nemesis and my salvation.
We've been working on this as long as I've been on the board.
That's right.
And so I think we're going to keep working on this.
Yes, yes. And we enjoy working with staff, and we've got a good working relationship with Tracy and staff. And there's a lot of work going forward, defining the 1 pound a day. One of the issues is a 325,000 ATUs per hour that's based on potential to emit on a 24-hour basis, which virtually nothing runs at. So those are things that we're going to work with staff on and try and define what those items are so that when the rule comes out, it's a workable rule and equitable and enforceable.
And that will be my direction too. Yeah, please keep working with these folks.
Oh, no, we will.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 Thank you.
Thank you.
Morning. I wasn't going to testify, but my name is Jerry Panetto. I'm the Vice President of Government Affairs, Printing Industries of California. I just want to follow up on handbills to just emphasize what the issue was. They got caught in the trap of, in the rule of relocation. And relocation issue is what kicks them into retrofitting the burner. Now, the burners we're talking about there, emissions are under 1 pound a day. And we're looking for some relief on that, at least in the short term, because we're up against a threshold or of having to either comply or shut down. So it's really that relocation issue. And we did see as an issue, a problem, if we're under 1 pound a day, we're willing to put on monitors and everything and to shut down the police to stay under that, at least in the interim, so we can dig out of the issue financially. I just wanted to kind of reemphasize that. Appreciate your time, and we look forward to working with you on that, Tracy.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bill's only been waiting for, I don't know, six or eight months to do this 3 minutes.
We would never be done with this until Bill Lamar speaks.
Actually, what Handbill didn't say is that a replacement press is costing about $9 million.
Wow.
Hi, I'm Bill Lamar. I'm the executive director of the California Small Business Alliance. And I was so looking forward to coming here today and telling you all that we had finally worked through with the staff to achieve that 3.5 tons a day of NOx emission reductions that the rule calls for without causing unnecessary harm to local employers. Unfortunately, I can't do that today, as you've heard from an actual business owner. As many of you committee members know, one of our major objections has been the promise made to small businesses. The promises over the years for 6 years, nearly 6 years,
but not kept. So some may also recall the hundreds of alarmed and angry small business owners who packed the auditorium in September 2011 to let you know that this is a rule that's more damaging to small business than it is beneficial to air quality. With new leadership of the district that includes Tracy, we've seen an improved rule gradually emerge. We're not at all surprised that the district's own consultant agreed with the staff's 5 recommendations in the technical assessment. However, we still strongly believe that less than a pound a day units should be exempt from the rule. In fact, 4.5 years ago, I wrote a letter to the staff and testified to the governing board that these units should be moved out of 1147 and suggested that they be moved into Rule 222, where they would be registered while still requiring owner-operators to furnish data about their emissions. The staff has consistently stonewalled us, saying that they'll look into it or that they continue to look into it. We also suggested that staff consider exempting less than a pound a day units in the same fashion that they did with 1153.1, which was for confectionery food ovens. While we believe that this is precedent setting, staff's response continued to be that they're looking into it. As Mr. Bonetto said, Dr. Bonetto said, another worrisome aspect of the proposed amended rule is about delaying compliance. That's the wording in the rule. Until the heating system in a unit is modified, replaced, or relocated. In the 2011 amendment of Rule 1147, staff has used the term new, relocated, or modified, and they define modified as meaning replacement of the burner. Relocating a unit can mean anything from moving it from one location within a business to moving the entire business to another address. Merely relocating the unit or moving the entire business doesn't mean that their emissions will increase. In fact, they could remain the same. They could even decrease. You've heard from a small business owner who relocated his business and is going to be severely punished by the district for doing so. We ask that you urge staff to either remove the word relocate from the proposed amended rule or make it applicable only if the relocation results in an increase in emissions. Staff has told you that they intend to work with us after the rule is amended. Because of the long history of promises being made but not kept, we ask that you direct staff to resolve these issues with us before bringing the rule to the governing board for approval. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
Any other public comments?
This isn't direct, I'm Angela Johnson Mazaris from Earth Justice, and this isn't directly my issue, but I do want to voice a sympathy, a camaraderie, as it were, with the people who are here before you today. Now, I don't know enough about the background to know about what else is going on, but I just want to make this point. In a world where we're talking about a pound a day and the kinds of issues that these people are evidencing to you, and we're still talking about power plants getting repowered in the South Coast Air Basin, and we're not talking today about the refinery issue that I thought was going to be on today's agenda, I would just urge us to think in a way that's more comprehensive. I think we need to think about how all these pieces fit together, both inside and outside of this AQMP, and recognize that as we think about where the burdens lie to make sure we get to our really important health standards, we should be careful that we're not letting some people off the hook or we're holding other people accountable. So I have to say that.
Any other public comment? Thank you. Judith?
Well, again, my favorite rule seems like I've been working with this. And I can remember saying, probably back in 2011, that these small businesses are the backbone of our economy, and we really have to work with them. And they provide tremendous in the number of jobs in our economy. And I think that the statistics will show that they are the biggest job provider. So on what we heard this morning, I would like staff to respond to a couple of things that Mr. Lamar brought up. The £1 a day issue and the rule 222, whether those can be worked together. The relocation language and how that is defined, perhaps that's something else that I'd like you to comment on. And the third thing was that some of these issues should be worked out before that rule comes to the board. Said was recorded on my iPad.
Was it really?
Now I don't know why Siri heard me and she's not going to jump on.
Siri has a comment.
Yes.
Modern technology.
Siri's going to tell you that she doesn't really understand what you're saying.
Just ask her how to solve the rule language.
Yeah. Should I just give it to you and just rewrite it for us? Well, I do have to admit, I came into this role after Joe Casmassi. So,
right, you did.
So I'm gonna ask Gary Quinn, who's the supervisor of the group that did the technology assessment, to help me here. But with regards to the relocation question, I think we're talking about physical relocation to another facility or to another location. And when that happens, we have NSR requirements that kick in, permitting requirements that kick in.
And that's
for small sources?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. They.
These are all permitted sources.
All permitted sources.
Yes.
Okay.
Any way to address that? I mean, they said if you go in and find out that this relocated equipment isn't emitting anymore,
they would kick into new source review, and then they would have to comply with the same requirements.
And then that's
maybe even more stringent.
Oh dear. Okay.
Yeah. It is a problem.
Clean Air Act.
That is a problem.
But let us put our heads together,
yeah,
sure.
See if there's something that can be worked out with that, especially when they're not, the emissions have an increase, so it's the same thing.
If it's not increased someday, it's less than a pound.
So,
and then on some of the issues, when you're talking about like the 222 and less than a pound per day, one of the examples that Bill has brought up has been the spray booths. And when it comes to spray booths here, for relative to NOx, we're talking about heaters. But spray booths are a control device. They not only control particulate, but they also, whatever's being used within those, they're also controlling. And one of the concerns that we have consistently had is what else is being emitted in conjunction with the use of that control device. And that's where our permitting staff would evaluate for toxics, VOC impacts, and the like. I don't know if you want to add to that.
Okay. And then before you bring that rule back to the board, I want you to continue to work with our stakeholders on those. I don't think it's fully baked yet from the furnaces that we're regulating.
If I could just mention, we have a compliance date that kicks in July 1st. The recommendations that came from the tech assessment, we need to move on those so that we give the relief so those requirements don't kick in on July 1st, so they have relief from the title requirements. So I believe if necessary, we can bifurcate the rulemaking and continue to work with them. And we've committed to do that.
Okay.
The issues of costs that were brought up, we're going to continue to work with Tony on, particularly when it comes to the maintenance and retrofit costs. We need to get into that more so that we can try to address some of those key issues. And we'll definitely look into more with the language with regards to that relocation.
Okay. Chairman, if I may, we didn't come today thinking the rule was fully baked. This is
an
update.
No,
yeah.
It says keep working.
Yeah, so
I understand.
We'll come back, the typical 6 weeks before the board meeting when we work out some of the issues.
All right.
I understand the relocation issue can provide a hardship, but, if you remodel, you now have to come under the new construction codes, and you didn't do anything but just, remodel your room. If I buy a house, I lost my Prop 13 protection. So, there are consequences sometimes to moving that seem like it's not fair. I'm just going from 1,300 square feet to 1,300 square feet, but,
now you
have
to
comply with some new requirements.
Yeah, and this has been a tough rule.
Yeah,
and it's one that some people probably wish we never approached.
Well, it covers so many,
yeah,
like 4,000 or something like that.
Yes, it's a significant number of sources.
Well, I can tell you that when I went back to Washington, D.C. with Supervisor Benoit last year, I was, first of all, a little amazed that he was even there, because he was there arguing with EPA to pass a new regulation, which made him, other than you, my favorite Republican. So we were in those meetings, and he said, the reason I'm arguing for this regulation is because if we don't get those mobile source reductions, we're going to have to impact those businesses that employ people within our district.
Yep.
And so it was very, you know, insightful. It made an impression upon me. And I do think, you know, I mean, 0.9 tons per day can be made up with probably one control device on one back end of one processing unit at one refinery quite easily. That is not gone in, and certainly the largest source of NOx emissions being heavy-duty trucks, you know, we can get those emission reductions elsewhere without having the severe impact on local businesses who are employing people. So, I mean, I really would love, and I share the same frustration that, you know, that Judy has over the years of dealing with this rule. It's, it's a pain, and it's it puts us right at that point where we're doing all the things that we don't want to do in order to get those little bits of
teeny bits of
progress that we need to get to attainment, which, as you know, I mean, as me of all people, it's my highest priority. But this is where it really gets ugly. And I'm glad, I mean, I think you guys are doing as best a job you can. I want you to continue to do it, work with these businesses and these employers and try to figure it out and try to make up those foregone emission reductions however we can, while complying with the Clean Air Act, new sources, new requirements, and everything else.
Mm-hmm. Having only worked on this for, you know, taking this on in the last year or so, I feel your pain. More so than I thought I would.
On a daily basis. That's Joe White retired.
All right. With that, item six, is anyone here to testify on that item that could not be here next month? Unless someone jumps up, I would like to go ahead and move that to next month. With that, we have written reports attached, items 7, 8, and 9. Any other business by the members of the board?
No.
Any public comment, general public comment on items not on the agenda? Very good, thank you. We'll move on to the technology committee. Thank you all. We asked staff at the beginning of this meeting to look at potentially changing the timing of these meetings.
Yes.
We're going to continue to have these kinds of lengthy meetings. My personal opinion, we start a half hour later here and a half hour later for tech, but that's just my thought. So
it's not fair.
Throwing that out there, and we'll see what we can do down the road. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Mr. Jones.